Welcome back, geologists. Be here. Oh no, not again.
Oh, don't be such a stick in the mud. Miaverse B here. Oh. Sorry to interrupt, but Helen and I are on the cusp of a great historical discovery in Brazil. Since Helen is a historical geologist, I'll let her break it down.
Hey, Helen here.
Okay, other me, you can drop the act now.
I'm not other you, I'm Helen. But where was I? Oh, yes. Our team is currently studying the Mesosaurus, an ancient freshwater reptile from Earth's past.
You want to learn more about that? Ugh. Well, if it lived so long ago, how do you even study it?
I'm so glad you asked. The key lies in fossils, which reveal not just the story of the Mesosaurus, but the story of Earth itself. In today's expedition, we'll identify different types of fossils, determine how they are formed, and discover what they tell us about our planet as a whole. Ready, geologists? Let's get to digging! Welcome back! I'm so glad you could join us here at the Santana Formation in Brazil. It's home to tons of fossils, which are the preserved remains or traces of animals, plants, and other organisms from Earth's past. Scientists who study fossils are called paleontologists. Let me show you the exciting discovery my team just made. Check it out! It's a complete fossil of a Mesosaurus. The very discovery my team was hoping for. This is a body fossil, which is the preserved remains of an organism's actual body parts, such as bones, teeth, or shells. Most body fossils are only parts of a living thing, such as a tooth or a claw, so this complete specimen is a rare find. Oh, hey, B. So, I have a question, other me. I mean, Helen. Is there a difference between that fossil and, say, a bone my dog just buried in the backyard? Besides, you know, how old they are?
Excellent question, Bee.
This fossil definitely looks like a skeleton, and it certainly used to be, but now it's closer to a unique kind of rock instead. Fossils are formed in a variety of ways, but the most common method is permineralization. This is when the once living tissues of an organism are replaced with mineralized rock.
So the bones were turned to stone?
More like parts of the bones were replaced with stone instead.
And this just happens?
Only when conditions are just right. In order for a fossil to form, the body needs to be buried quickly, usually in sediment such as sand. Water and minerals must be present as well. That way, water can seep into the decomposing remains, carrying dissolved minerals along for the ride. When the water eventually evaporates, it leaves the minerals behind where living tissue used to be. The end result is a fossil, made up of mineralized rock in the shape of the original bones.
So, can this happen to any once living tissue? Why are there only bones here?
Another great question, B. Why only bones indeed?
Geologists, any ideas?
Soft tissues like skin and muscles usually decompose too quickly for permineralization to occur. It's most common in structures like bones, shells, or tough plant material, which have sturdy structures that maintain their original shape. So, B, the bone your dog buried could become a fossil, but only under these specific conditions, and only if your dog doesn't dig it up first. And speaking of digging, Let's keep looking around to see what other fossils we can find. Ooh, jackpot! Here we have a fossil of an ancient clam species. This is a mold fossil, which is formed when the remains of a living thing leave an impression in a rock, but the remains decay completely and disappear. Here's another example from my personal collection. How cool is that? Oh, looks like my team just made another discovery. This is another kind of fossil called a trace fossil. It's formed by traces of activity from living things long ago. It's like a little clue left behind on the earth about how this animal lived. Besides footprints, what other kinds of trace fossils do you think exist? Okay, some good ideas. Some other examples include nests, burrows, and even petrified droppings. Okay, maybe not the most pleasant topic for most. So why do geologists care about this? Why do we care about fossils at all? Let's back up. I want you to imagine that you are Robert Plot, who discovered the first recorded dinosaur fossil way back in 1677. I mean, this fossilized bone was huge and didn't match anything alive today. How would you react? And as more fossils were discovered, what questions would you ask? Pause and record your thoughts in your notes. Right away, I'm wondering, what can fossils tell us about past life on Earth? Let's take another look at our Mesosaurus fossil we found. It has features similar to modern crocodiles, and we also found fossilized fish scales where its stomach would have been. What do you think these clues tell us about how the Mesosaurus lived? Pause and record your thoughts in your notes. The Mesosaurus likely spent much, if not all, of its time in the water and ate a diet of fish and other aquatic animals. Trace fossils like footprints and nests can also provide important details about how it behaved in the past. Even fossilized droppings, if we can find them, would provide clues about the Mesosaurus's diet. And that's just information about one extinct animal. Altogether, fossils provide a record of countless species on Earth and how they might have lived. But that's not the only reason scientists are interested in fossils. Back in the late 1800s, there were still a lot more unanswered questions, like, when did these fossilized creatures roam the Earth? How are they connected to living things today? And what can they tell us about our planet as a whole? Fast forward to 1905, and a huge breakthrough occurred that would shine a new light on the field of geology. The invention of radiometric dating gave us the ability to determine the age of rocks, including fossils. Ooh, that's a complicated equation. More on this later. For now, how do you think radiometric dating has changed how scientists study fossils? Now fossils weren't just evidence of past life, they were a physical timeline for it. By comparing the age of various fossils, scientists discovered that the oldest fossils came from the sea, the origin of all life on Earth. As more and more fossils were discovered, they revealed the incredible story of how life has changed over time. But fossils don't just tell a story of living things. Remember these fossils of sea creatures in the Grand Canyon? By studying the characteristics of fossils, geologists can understand more about the conditions of the environment they lived in. Sea creatures provide evidence of aquatic environments, but what do you think tropical plant fossils suggest about the places they are found? I'm thinking, these tropical plants likely lived in a warm and humid climate when they were alive. And with radiometric dating, we can tell not only where, but roughly when these climates existed and how they changed. In this way, fossils help show us the history of our entire planet. Pretty incredible stuff, right? Let's recap what we've learned today. Fossils are the preserved remains or traces of animals, plants, and other organisms from Earth's past. The main kinds are body fossils, mold fossils, and trace fossils. Body fossils are usually formed by permineralization, which is when the once living tissues of an organism are replaced with mineralized rock. Fossils are important because they tell us what life has existed here and how it has changed over time. This information, in turn, provides important clues about our planet's history as a whole. Of course, sometimes clues also invite more questions, like, why are there Mesosaurus fossils in both South America and Africa, separated by a huge ocean, and nowhere else? We'll unravel this mystery in our next lesson, where we'll discuss how the Mesosaurus inspired a bold hypothesis, one that slowly shifted how geologists view the entire geosphere. Until then, I'm Helen, and remember, today's present is tomorrow's history, so make it count and make it rock, geologists. Stay observant, keep asking questions, and I'll see you next time. Hey, hey.